It's a privilege to be given this topic in this period. Because what an exciting time. It's an amazing period in which we clearly are now in an era of mass protests. And mass protests with a very strong anti-capitalist potential. Really beginning in Greece in 2008, I'll just run through the list of countries where there have been very large movements. Tunisia, Egypt, Spain, Portugal, Wisconsin, it's not a country, but it's important. The whole Occupy movement in North America, Nigeria, India, Chile, Quebec, Turkey, Brazil. And I probably missed some out, and comrades who tell me I've missed them out, I hope you'll make good contributions from the floor. And what's happened in these movements is that we've seen people demanding radical social changes, making challenges to neoliberal capitalism, demanding an end to inequalities and to state authoritarianism. Sometimes these have involved mass strikes, sometimes indeed they haven't. At least some of them have been revolutions, some of them something less. They've involved the criticism, deep popular criticism, of the limits of parliamentary democracy and of existing socialist, social democratic parties. There have been some experiments, popular experiments in new forms of democracy. And however confusing it may have been, the demonstration on my 74th birthday, on the 30th of June, 2013, was said by the BBC to be the largest demonstration in the history of the world. So it's a privilege to be here, really, and to try and talk about it. Now, there's quite a distance. Let's recognise there's quite a distance between the achievements of the movement so far and any possible vision of socialist revolution. And that doesn't mean that those movements aren't hugely important, but the revolutionary standpoint is, in a sense, very important for judging them and their limits and their possibilities. Now, what conditions, we can ask, make socialist revolution possible? And I think we can go back to good old Lenin, who offered a definition of a revolutionary situation. He said there are two features of a revolutionary situation. The first is that the ruling class can't continue to rule in the old way. Doesn't mean they can't continue to rule, but they can't continue to rule in the old way. And the second condition is that the masses are no longer willing to be ruled in the old way. It doesn't mean they're not willing to be ruled, but not in the old way. And essentially, what it means is a full-scale political crisis in society marked by a rise in ordinary people's combativity. That's the heart of the idea of a revolutionary situation. Now, when you think about it, a revolutionary situation is not a single event. It's a process going on. I mean, the German Revolution, which didn't in the end succeed in becoming a social revolution, lasted from November 1918 right through to the autumn of 1923. A 5 years really long revolutionary situation. The most important thing that happens in a revolutionary situation from our standpoint is a social psychological process, which is that people, ordinary people, change. In Egypt, in 2011, somebody said at Marxism, fear changed sides. Brilliant summary of what happened in January and February of 2011. What happens is that popular confidence in the possibility of changing the world rises. Popular determination to change things rises. Lenin had a beautiful phrase in the 1905 revolution. He said, every revolution is a festival of the oppressed. People suddenly feel happy in a way and hopeful in a way that they didn't before. They haven't won anything yet, but they see they see possibilities that they didn't see before. And that is the central precondition and the central element of revolutionary possibility, that ordinary people begin to see the possibility of themselves changing the world. Without that, socialism isn't possible. I think that we have to, we have to say that's a central process. And what it means also is that people's capacity to rule changes, that it expands. In a revolution, said Lenin, people become capable of performing miracles. And I think that's a very nice way of putting it. You don't think of Lenin as a poet of revolution, but actually he was. Now, what happens in a revolutionary situation, in other words, is that people go through very rapid processes of learning, far beyond anything that you can achieve in the classroom. Quite different, in fact, from what goes on in classrooms. They develop new goals, new aims and aspirations for themselves and for their friends and their colleagues and their comrades and their brothers and sisters. They develop a new sense of who they are. They develop a new sense of who their allies are and potential friends and allies are. And they also develop a new sense of their opponents. They learn to laugh at their opponents and not just to fear them, not to obey them necessarily. But they don't do it all at once. It's not the case that people move from being where they are suddenly to be full-blown socialist revolutionaries. They go. Trotsky has this beautiful expression in his marvelous History of the Russian Revolution, which is perhaps the best book that was written in the 20th century. He says, the masses learn, he said, by the method of successive approximation. Another word for it is trial and error. They try something out. You look at the development of the revolution in Egypt. It's not the case that the demonstrations at the beginning called for the overthrow of Mubarak. That became a popular demand several days into the Egyptian revolution. Then they got rid of Mubarak, and then they discovered they got something else which they didn't like. And so there's another movement, and then another movement. And now they've overthrown Morsi. Now where do we go? A method of successive approximations, trial and error. We're not there yet. We don't know what, you know, we're not satisfied. The biggest demonstration in world history, we're not satisfied with what we've got. What will come next? Everything is open. Everything is possible. Fantastic situation to be in. But it's also the case that if the revolutionary movement amongst the ordinary people goes through a process of successive approximations, it's a process that can very easily be halted. It can be thrown back. Learning can stop very easily in a process of if there are defeats. Because no revolution ever advances from its initiation to its conclusion on some easy, on some easy glide path, as it were, just on an ever upward trajectory. Rather, there are advances and retreats. There are halts and stumbles and backward movements. There are splits and divisions where previously there'd been unity. There are turning points in the whole process. Very dramatic, always, the history of revolution. There's sudden shifts and changes and turning points. There are big arguments that go on, very big arguments. And into those moments of turning points and so on, it is not the case that the only voices that are heard are the voices of revolutionaries. Not by any means. There are a million and one voices of reformism. That are heard. Now, reformism at the time of the Russian Revolution had relatively deep, shallow roots. But that's not true of even of Egypt today, and it's certainly not true of the countries of Europe or of America and so on. Reformism is very, very deeply implanted. And so there are always people who come along and say, really, we mustn't go too far. It's time for us to take breath and halt, or we should trust so-and-so. Polish workers were told to trust the Pope, believe it or not, by the leaders of Solidarity, this most marvelous movement. You should trust the army, the workers are told in Egypt now. Trust the army. Trust an army? Trust the left union leaders. Trust the left union leaders. Trust your MPs. Trust your councillors. Trust the imam. Trust the priests. Trust... Oh, God, they'll invent new people to trust as well. Not trust yourself and your own strength. Not trust your brothers and sisters. Not trust what you can do next. That's the message. Now, many years ago, E.P. Thompson, the great socialist historian, 50 years ago, in fact, wrote a very important essay in which he said, a lot of people forget how the English working class has warrened capitalism from end to end. You know, actually... So much of what we take for granted in society is the achievement of past working class struggles. And he's absolutely right, except that he didn't offer the reverse proposition, which is, of course, that people also forget how the English workers' movement has been warrened from end to end by the capitalist class and its institutions and its assumptions and so on. Gramsci talked about how revolution in the West, as he put it, in advanced capitalist societies, is not simply a matter of wars of maneuver, of, you know, a dash at the state, as it were, but beat the police and that's it. Rather, he said, you have to overcome all the earthworks of civil society, all the organizations in society and all the assumptions in society and all the practices in society that contain us within the limits of capitalism. And at every juncture in the development of a revolutionary situation, unless there are socialists pointing the way forward and putting forward an alternative argument, then somebody else will suggest something other than that the movement should advance. So a movement can advance spontaneously to a point, and then it will face the question, what next? And there will be a host of voices suggesting all sorts of different things, and unless there are socialists there with clarity and numbers and unity to put forward a socialist argument about what's the way forward, somebody else will argue something else, and the movement will retreat. Another thing to note, every revolutionary situation begins with a minority of people involved. Now, in Egypt, in 2011, I saw an estimate that between 20 and 25% of the population of Egypt, the adult population of Egypt, participated in the demonstrations that overthrew Mubarak. That's a fantastic number of people. And, well, we saw it on our television screens. What a big the size of those demonstrations and so on. 20 to 25%. But 20 to 25% is a minority. The revolution in Egypt only involved a quarter of the adult population. It began at the beginning. It hasn't finished yet. More people were involved 2 weeks ago in the demonstrations than were involved in the demonstrations that overthrew Mubarak. The question is, in the development of a revolutionary situation, whether it deepens, whether it widens, whether it poses new questions. Does it involve new people, new layers? Does it draw in the smaller towns as well as the big cities? Does it draw in peasants? Does it draw in the small shopkeepers? Does it draw in all sorts of other things? And how does it draw them in is another question. Because Rosa Luxemburg wrote the most wonderful pamphlet called The Mass Strike, in which he talked about how people sometimes denigrate mere economic demands, you know, demands for wages or for better conditions in particular workplaces. And particularly in a revolution, you think, it doesn't matter, these workers are demanding a few more kopecks or a few more shekels or a few more pence or whatever it is. Actually, it's absolutely vital, because this is the way in which people, for the first time, if they've been completely subordinate to the boss, if they are able to begin to fight for a few pennies or for a reduction in the working day or the sacking of a brutal foreman, that is the way in which they enter the movement. Because unless you can challenge the foreman, you certainly can't challenge the whole capitalist system. So this is the way in which people become involved for the first time. So economic strikes are vitally important in terms of mobilizing people, raising popular confidence, beginning new processes of self-organization amongst workers, and so on. But it's also true that the oppressed have new opportunities in revolutionary situations, that people who had to keep silent before or who went in fear before see new openings and new possibilities. I don't know if you noticed it, but during 2 years ago in Tahrir Square, it was a fantastic picture of Coptic Christians standing guard while Muslims prayed in Tahrir Square. Now, you look at the history of antagonism between Coptic Christians and Muslims, with the Muslims tending to oppress the Copts, and you see the advance that involved. The question of religious persecution is one that a movement like a revolutionary movement can begin to challenge in practice. There are serious questions about the involvement of women in the revolutions in the Middle East. Marvelous speaker yesterday from Syria talked about how the Syrian revolution, as he put it, is creating hundreds of new Rosa Luxemburgs. And there was a beautiful expression. You see, the role of women in the Egyptian revolution is seriously challenged at the same time that it's expanding. there are groups of men who are going around terrorizing women in Tahrir Square. And then they are themselves being controlled and combated by squads of men who support the rights of women. And so you get this internal conflict within the revolution. Shall women be active and equal participants in the revolution? And of course, the other thing is that when you talk about people becoming involved in a revolution, the ways in which people become involved are different. Some people become involved in street fighting, but that's not the only way to become involved in a revolution. And that's not the only way in which people become involved in a mass movement. In Tahrir Square, people needed to be fed. People organized food. Now, you might think that's not very revolutionary. You think that you can have a revolution without any food? Without water in the heat of Tahrir Square. People organized that. There were doctors who organized medical services. That's part of being in the revolution. Most of the time, doctors don't organize medical services for uprisings, but when they do, they change. They themselves become different. The miners' wives in 1984-5, you look at the photographs, they became part of the miners' strike precisely, and they began with the organization of food in the miners' villages. People who organized security in the gates of the Lenin shipyard in 1980, or the people who organized security in Tahrir Square, were also performing a revolutionary function and developing their patterns of organization, of popular organization. The people who drew cartoons that people took up and copied in Tahrir Square were performing a service to the revolution. The people who read poetry to the Lenin shipyard workers when they were occupying their workers, there was an efflorescence of working class poetry in the summer of 1980 in the Lenin shipyard. That's part of the process of developing the revolution as well. Because what a revolutionary situation does is to open up society in all sorts of ways, and it reveals and it mobilizes all sorts of discontents and so on. It's not just about wages and conditions. It's much more. It's about people start talking about big ideas like freedom. Freedom is more than wages and conditions. I earn enough, to be honest. But I'm not free. I want so much more from life. I want blue skies and happiness and world peace solidarity and a sense of struggle across the world. I want to see socialism before I die. That's more than wages and conditions. Questions about religious oppression, about racial and ethnic oppression, about gender oppression, about the police ill-treatment of sports fans, about official bullying and corruption, about corporate crimes and the monopolies and so on, about the usury, the robbery by usurers, like the short, you know, these people who will lend you money on short term at incredible rates of interest in poor areas in Britain, all those sorts of things, about the landlords who extort money from peasants and so on. All of these questions are raised as possible issues in a revolutionary situation. Of course, it's complicated then by the fact that the people who come, Lenin said, you can't build the society of today with the bricks of tomorrow. You have to rely on people come into a revolutionary situation with what they've got. And they come in often with all sorts of prejudices. It's not the case that everybody who joins in a revolutionary movement is anti-sexist or is not homophobic or not racist and so on. They do. People come in with all sorts of prejudices initially from the old society. People come, the Turkish demonstrations had lots of people waving Turkish flags. And you might say, oh, these clearly, they're nationalist demonstrations, completely no future in them, completely right-wing, etc. Then you have to go and ask the people who are waving the flags why they're waving the flags, because that's the first thing that came to hand, firstly. And secondly, it's against international capitalism. It's the first way of expressing that. It's claiming the nation for yourself rather than letting the rulers claim it. So you have to not just be condemnatory, look at the possibilities in it. And how, in the process of the development of a revolutionary situation, do old ideas get challenged in practice? How does homophobia get challenged? How does racism get challenged? How does the oppression of ethnic minorities, of religious minorities, get challenged? How does the position of women get challenged in practice? That's the vital question. It's not the case ever that the working class enters a revolution or even at the end of the revolution. A working class is a unified political force. There are always majorities and minorities. What makes revolutions are movements. The question is, what's their shape and who's involved and what possibilities do they... But movements themselves are very complicated and messy entities. But they are the central actors in revolutions. The class struggle is fought out not simply between the exploiters and the exploited. It's also fought out amongst the ranks of the exploited. It goes on. That's what's going on in the arguments in Tahrir Square. It's an argument among... A class struggle is running within the movement as well about how it should go forward and so on. Now, what makes socialist... Twain, last question, really, with a few minutes to... Yes, I've got a few minutes. Have I? Yes? Yeah. What makes a socialist revolution possible? What will we look for if we're looking specifically for the possibility of socialist revolution? Because everything I've said now is about revolution in general. I think there are two key issues. One is politics, about politics, and one's about economics. The vital question that makes it possible, that makes you ask, is a socialist revolution possible, is this. Are new social institutions being created from below? New political institutions being created from below? And here we disagree fundamentally with the anarchists and some autonomists, because the question is not whether we should create new state organizations. For us, it's how and what sort. The anarchists say, we don't want a workers' state. We don't want any kind of state. We say, we do, but we want an entirely new kind of state. And I'll try and explain the argument a little bit. See, Gramsci, the great Italian communist writer, said this. I haven't got many quotes, but this is one. The subaltern classes, in other words, us, the subaltern classes, by definition, are not unified and cannot unite until they become a state. The people, ordinary people, have to become, he said, a state. Now, what kind of state? That's the question. It's not, the argument is not, do they or not form a state, but the real argument is, what sort of state? And Marx really answered the question when he wrote about the Paris Commune. Because the principles of the Paris Commune for Marx were an enormous learning curve for Marx, by the way. Because before, he said, basically, he changed his mind about the question of state power when he, in the light, or became clear about the question of state power in the light of the experience of the Paris Commune back in 1871. Because he said the principles of a future socialist government were laid out, were discovered by the Commune. What were they? Everybody should be elected. Nobody should hold office because somebody gave it to them from above. Everybody should be elected, first principle. Second principle, everybody who is elected should be recallable. They're not elected for 5 years and they can sit there in Parliament for 5 years. You should be able to recall your MP if you're not satisfied with her or him. And they shouldn't get any privileges. They shouldn't get special pay for being a delegate to some organisation. They should... As Richard Boyd Barrett was speaking last night, he's a socialist comrade who's an MP, a TD as they call them in Ireland. He gets an ordinary worker's wage, and he is under the control of his organisation, and they spend his money for him and decide what he can spend it on the rest. Excellent, excellent. But a socialist MP, there are very few of them around. There's one in Ireland, I think there might be a few in Portugal, and that's about it. And we have a socialist councillor in Preston. Hooray, that's about it. But the last... So no elected, recallable, no privileges. But perhaps the most important thing Marx pointed to, he said, above all, these bodies have to be practical. They have to carry out their own decisions. They don't have to make decisions and then somebody else carries them out. They have to carry out... In other words, find out whether they made their own decisions correctly by doing them themselves. Now, how do such bodies arise? And the answer is, it seems to me, they arise out of the very necessities of the struggle. You see, during the... There are lots of examples going back through the whole of the 20th century and into our century. 1919, there was a general strike in Seattle, and all traffic stopped. And then the lorries started to run again, only now the lorry drivers carried a pass from the General Strike Committee giving them permission to drive, to carry food and other needed things around the city. But no lorry moved unless it had a pass from the strike committee. The same thing happened in Gdansk in the summer of 1980. The trams started to run again, only now they were covered with posters saying, "We are working to support the people's interest." And when the fleet came in from the fishing fleet came into the port of Gdansk, the strike committee ordered that the canneries should open so the fish wouldn't be wasted. And the fish was produced, was canned under workers' control. Excellent, excellent. We're not in favour of waste. In Egypt, when the police were beaten off the streets and withdrew, and suddenly there was a danger that there would be all sorts of crime in the neighbourhoods of Cairo, people set up local elected neighbourhood committees, improvised them, popular committees to police, food organisation. Same thing at Gdansk, they organised the food supplies, and the places, the factories that occupied them didn't work out their food supplies. Actually, the strike was very weak because, you know, hungry workers don't make good workers. Same in Tahrir Square. Workers' committees, the question is, are workers' committees taking over the running of workplaces? And now we have this marvellous example from Egypt, from Greece, I apologise to the Greek comrades, where for the last month, and I think it's 4 days now, the equivalent of the BBC in Greece has been occupied under workers' control, and they are continuing to broadcast under workers' control. And and it's apparent, what the Greek comrades say, is that it's inspiring other workers. If they can do it, why can't we do it? Now, there you do see the beginning of the actual revolutionary possibility. It goes beyond protest into beginning to say, OK, we're going to take over, we're going to run society. And it involves ordinary people engaged in the direct problem solving about what should we do, what should we say, how should we organise things, and so on, with very important social psychological effects on the people who are doing that. Now they are in charge. This is a different kind of world that is beginning to emerge. It's not just the political militants, ordinary people beginning to take charge. So the question in relation to such developments is simply, how wide are such developments? How deep do they go? That's the first question. How far is such a network of popular control developing? And secondly, how far is such a movement in different places starting to coordinate its activities, trying to unify such networks? Because when you take those two questions together, then you begin to ask, to what extent is the movement pushing to make this the basis of a new political constitution for society? And that's the key question of socialist revolution. Now, Trotsky said that only the slogan of Soviet revolution was able to unify. It wasn't Bolshevik revolution, it had to be Soviet, the revolution of the Soviets, of the ordinary committees, had to be the thing that would unify the movement. It was the only slogan also that could draw in different social layers. It was a form, the commune form or the Soviet form was transferable to different settings. It could be used in a workplace, but it could also be used in a neighbourhood. It could be used in a village. It could be used in a school. The kids can have one with their teachers, as much as workers can have one in a factory, and so on. The form, said Marx, was simple, like all great things. And he said also it was a thoroughly expansive form. And it's a form with, once it exists, people can identify, and it can become incredibly popular. There's a writer during the Russian Revolution whose name I've forgotten, it doesn't matter, a reformist writer, who says how awful it is that the Soviet is so popular with people. People go to it to solve all their problems. They knock on the door and demand that a woman comes and complains about her husband to the Soviet. Everything they bring to the Soviet. And then you see exactly the same thing with the rise of solidarity in Poland. Reformists saying, oh, it's terrible. People are looking to solidarity to solve all their problems. And exactly the same language that was used by Sukarnov, it was, in Russia so many years before. These new popular institutions attract people, because they involve them and they enliven them and they empower them in ways that previously they hadn't imagined. Okay, that's the politics. Last, I'm running out of time, so quickly on the question of economics. Marx said of the Paris Commune that it is was the political form under which to work out the economic emancipation of labour. He didn't say it solved it. He said it was the political form in which you could solve the economic problems. It didn't solve them, but it was the form in which you could. because fundamental to the question of socialism is whether there is, firstly, an absolute turnover of class power. Is the working class in power? Because you can't begin to create the deal with the questions of the economy unless the working class has taken power into its hands. But then it does face the question of how to reorganise production and distribution on an entirely different basis. And the questions are quite complicated, and I can only touch on them, and we should really have lots and lots more discussions about these sorts of questions, because they're going to be on our agendas again now that all these movements are rising. But it seems to me there are three tasks, really, that the first stages of a revolution face in terms of economics. The first one is simply to get to grips with the economic crisis that generated the revolutions in the first place. Because revolutions do not happen in periods of rapid capitalist booms. It's crisis that produces revolutions. And the upsurge, a revolutionary upsurge, is not good for the economy. So it actually makes it worse. Economic life is more difficult as a result of massive strikes and demonstrations and stoppages of production. There's actually shortages developing of all sorts and so on. Chaos, in lots of ways, is created by revolution. We have to admit this. So the first thing a revolution has to do is first task, in a sense, is dealing with that, trying to sort out the mess and get things going again. And then the second and third things are really dealing with the core of beginning to move beyond the core of the capitalist way of organising. And what's that? The two facets of working class existence that need to be challenged. The first one is being bossed around, and the second is being divided by competition in the market. There's, you know, that's the thing that defines being a worker, in a sense. Being bossed around, being told what to do by somebody else who earns more than you and is absolutely horrible, and secondly, being divided by competition. And the truth is that we very, very little experience historically of successes in this line. Actually, the Russian Revolution has very little to teach us about this. There's a very short period after the revolution when massive economic crisis, basically, the Bolsheviks never really do get a hold of the problem. They stagger from crisis to crisis. So we should really have a very, very low standard of measurement of success. If we could get under workers' control, let's say the British economy, back to the state where everybody's got a job and everybody's got a house and everybody's got enough to live on, that would be an amazing, historic achievement, right? Remember, under workers' control, okay? It would be something the working class has never done before in history. So don't think about flying to the moon as the first thing that we'll have to do under the socialist revolution. That will come somewhat later. Rather, let's make sure everybody's got enough spuds. Okay, and some butter, and maybe a little potted shrimps, or whatever you like to eat. Whatever you like to eat. You have to expand democracy in the workplace. It is the core of workers' control, is that democracy has to be expanded in the workplace. But it's not enough to expand democracy in each separate workplace. Because if the market continues to rule, the workplaces must compete with each other. And then we're all back to all the old shit again. And so the aim has to be, we used to call it an old term, cooperation, the cooperative planning of society. And you can't immediately leap into solving all those problems, but you can begin. You can begin to ask, where can we get rid of money? Well, you can say, we already know how the National Health Service works. Let's have a National Health Service on the buses. Let's have free buses for everybody. Okay. Let's have supermarkets. One part of the supermarket is the place, it's just a warehouse now. You go in and you just take what you need. So you can't do it with everything. But let's say spuds and bread and milk. And you can have a list of things. Basics. The things that basically they now price the lowest things. Let's put those now. You just go and get what you need. And people will take a bit too much because they don't think it's going to last and so on. But people don't actually go to the library and take all the books they can. They don't, and they don't leave the tap running because they don't have to pay for extra water and so on. So People don't go to the doctor when there's there are some people who are sick. Okay. Mostly people don't go to the doctor when there's nothing wrong with them and so on. It's old people and some, you know, I go to the doctor, but, you know, I'm not a spring chicken anymore. You can begin to ask, what new priorities can we set for society? What are our needs? And that's a huge, you can have a vast democratic discussion. What do we want to do with our society? What do we think are the most important needs? Probably housing would be high on anybody's list. Restoring the health service to proper health. You know, you could think of things that people would say, well, that's obvious. Or making that happen would be a work of several years just to work. But you bring society back. Okay, I'm winding up. The truth is, if we don't succeed in doing that, then somebody else, if the ordinary people don't succeed in doing that under their own control, somebody else will have to, and then all the old shit would begin again, unless it continues under popular control. And you actually, right, I'm going to run out. I've run out of time, so I'll quickly sum up. We can't be prescriptive about what the social bases around which people will organise will be. I mean, there was a time when I think you could think, well, the earlier part of this century, you'd look at the Putilov works in Russia. Seems to be a natural organising centre, the biggest factory, one of the biggest factories in the world. Obviously, it's going to be a centre of organisation. The River Rouge plant in Detroit, the huge car factory, a natural organising place for workers, beginning to assembly point almost for workers' power. Or the Lenin shipyard in Gdansk, 16,000 workers in one place. Natural place for workers to gather from all sorts of other workplaces and have their meetings and so on. But then you think today, I don't know, if you look around Manchester or Leeds or Sheffield or London, those big, big factories don't have the same sort of centrality as they did. I don't know what its implications are, but clearly other forms will emerge. I don't know what they'll be. And we have to be very open and very experimental about this and very ready to learn from the movement, because the movement will answer those questions when it needs to. And we don't know the answers because we haven't got the experience on which to base them. But we know from Bolivia, for example, that neighbourhood organisation was extremely important. There's a marvellous book by Jeff Weber, for example, which discusses this. So we just have to be ready to learn from the movement. About new forms of organisation, the social basis of them, and so on. Look out for good initiatives, good inventions coming up, bubbling up from below, and so on. Some of them will be people will come up with terrible ideas as well as good ideas. They'll have big arguments and so on. Final sentences. If we want to participate in such a process, and if we want it to succeed, we have to build a revolutionary socialist party. There is absolutely no way of avoiding that, because everybody, every other leader with every other kind of politics will also be active in such a situation, arguing other things than a revolutionary socialist way forward. We have to build such organisations, and as Sami Naguib wrote recently, you have to begin before the possibility emerges. We have to build now. We have to build in a united way. We may argue about how, but the case is irrefutable. The tragedy, I look back at, because I'm fairly elderly now, the thing that I studied 33 years ago, the marvellous movement, the last really big movement in Europe that could have challenged the whole system was the Solidarity movement in Poland. There wasn't one socialist organisation, two socialists organised together in Poland. That's the truth. No wonder they went down to defeat. No wonder. Nobody was there to pose an alternative. Then I look at Egypt. We've got an organisation in Egypt. The revolutionary socialists fill me with such happiness that I don't care if they're all mad. Well, actually, they're not. I would care if they're all mad. They're there. They're very serious. They're not huge. But, God, they're there. It makes everything possible. Let's make sure that we make everything possible. Thanks.
Yes, I thought that was a fascinating talk from Colin. I just want to kind of fill in a little bit, because at the end, Colin began to talk about, we can't predict, in a sense, the forms of organisation that are going to, or the forms of the centres of new power can emerge. But I think we can say, I mean, Rosa Luxemburg put it brilliantly, there, where the chains are forged, there we must have the liberation. That doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be this or that particular factory, although, you know, you can look at Egypt and you can see really Mahalla and all those kinds of centres, absolutely crucial in terms of the process of revolution going forward in terms of things. But, you know, in Britain, all right, we haven't got those kinds of things, but I mean, I do a bus garage sale, and what interests me about that is, of course, you think about transport workers, particularly in London, fantastic possibilities of power and making such a real difference in terms of everything that's to be done. The second point I want to make is a little bit really about Greece, because what's interesting about Greece is, of course, you've got the decay of reformism and so on and so forth, but you've got new forms of reformism emerging, which are quite tempting in lots of ways, and therefore, what Colin's talking about, the process of approximation, which I prefer to trial and error, approximation, is actually interesting, because, of course, Syriza reflects both the movement on the up, but also the limitations of reformism in a different guise. And therefore, what you have to have, and I think what our comrades in Greece particularly are very sharp about, is how do you work with and against that kind of thing? How do you make sure that you push the thing forward, you engage with the people who are looking to Syriza, but at the same time, you keep on emphasising the need for a revolutionary organisation that can actually build where it really is going to count in terms of the activity. Those are they're difficult issues in lots of ways, but the kind of question of a clarity of thought, a clarity of what you're doing, and then what that means in terms of the way you're going to organise, strikes me as absolutely essential. No doubt people make all kinds of mistakes, but I think it's not just in a sense of there's the process. We have to know how to intervene to take the process forward for the next link. Complex, but absolutely vital, because each link in the chain has the possibility, providing, in a sense, we're very conscious about what we're doing, of pointing to the ultimate goal, which is how all the protests come together in a process of revolution, which lends to the destruction of the old state and the institution, the new way of life under the kind of state that Colin is describing, that can begin to solve those very, very basic questions.
Okay, thanks, comrade. The next speaker will be followed by comrade in front.
Yeah, about how people change and how quickly things change. A couple of Fridays ago, I was talking to another member of the union in my workplace, and she's Kurdish, and her father had recently come out of prison after a year simply for being an official in the Kurdish party, and while he was inside, she had taken his position on the committee. And that morning, a young Kurdish boy had been shot in Liche, near Darbe, killed by the army. And she said to me, oh, she was really depressed, and she said, you know, look, all these things are going on in Gezi Park, but, you know, in my country, in Diyarbakir, they're using real bullets, not plastic bullets, and they're killing our people. And I said, Dijle, Turkey's changing. You know, don't be so depressed. And so we had a little talk about it. That evening, I posted something on Facebook, and then she wrote under what I'd written, and she said what she did. I was going home past Yorkshire Park, which is one of the forums in Kadıköy, and I was thinking the same thing. I was thinking, it's all right for you. It's only plastic bullets, and what do you care about us? And then I saw in the park that they had made an exact copy of the banner that was being carried in Lice when the boy was shot, which said, we want peace, not war. And they were starting a march in Kadıköy. They were starting a march that involved thousands of people carrying Turkish flags and portraits of Atatürk, shouting, Lice is everywhere, this Kurdish village is everywhere, resistance is everywhere. In other words, they were taking up the question of the murder of this Kurdish 18-year-old Kurdish boy. And she said, at lunchtime, I only believed you 1% when you said Turkey is changing, and now I do believe you. And that's how quickly things change. And there you have a building of trust between Turks and Kurds, the traditional enemies. You know, there's been so much propaganda, about the terrorist Kurds and so on. And then you see a two-way process. The Turks believing that the Kurds are oppressed, and the Kurds believing that the Turks are going to support them. And that's a fantastic change. I want to just say one other thing. My late mum used to teach art to maladjusted boys, and one of the boys produced a sculpture which he didn't take home, and I still have on my mantelpiece, and it's called A Perfect Life. And it's a man lying on a park bench with a big cigar in his mouth and a basket full of sandwiches and beer. Right? And this is his idea. And I thought to myself, what would be my idea of a perfect life? Well, you can scrap the cigar and put a pile of books. Right? And that would be my idea of a perfect life. And what was Gezi Park like? You go into Gezi Park, and the first thing that happens, someone comes up to you with a plate of food and
Wind up, comrade.
Do you want some food? I said, no, I'm not hungry. But you've got to eat! And it's free. And there's a library. And the food is being prepared by the LGBT organisations. And right next to the LGBT organisations are the anti-capitalist Muslims, sitting next to them and happily coexist. And there's a library where the books are free. So for 15 days, you saw a little picture, a tiny little picture of what socialism might be like. And then, of course, the state came and smashed it. Right? So, which is the other lesson, which is why we need to be organised, why we need to spread it, why we need a party, why we need, in the world, we need the contribution of the SWP, and please, please keep the SWP alive.
Comrade at the front will be followed by that comrade there.
See, the example Chris gave of people saying, you know, this Kurdish village is everywhere, it is all of us, and the examples given of people breaking with sexism, racism, etc., are examples of something bigger that happens both during revolutionary processes and struggles, and hopefully also after we have achieved socialism, which is the end of alienation, or the beginning of breaking of alienation. And what that results in is that people recover or gain something of what I might call the bigger picture. Now, what do we mean by alienation? In class society, and especially in capitalism, the work process alienates workers from the product of their labor. And I'm not just talking about people on a production line. I'm talking about health workers who have to churn out the targets and the cases and aren't asked, what do you think the target should be that you're supposed to meet? Or you know, you're not thinking about the health of the nation, just about your ward and, you know, have you processed enough, etc. Now, this affects all of us. It affects socialists as well. Alienation and competition in society affects us. And we can lose the sight of the bigger picture. And sometimes we can treat each other in rather objectified ways. You know, we can treat each other as objects. We can see each other, not necessarily see, you know, the Turk next door as the enemy, but the faction next door as the enemy. And we are losing the bigger picture. Now, it's not that socialists aren't alienated, but by being aware of it, you can correct a little bit for it. You can at least be aware of it and try to regain the bigger picture. And I don't know, many of you, no doubt, have seen friends, colleagues, comrades have breakdowns, nervous breakdowns. What do you see? You see people failing to function and losing temporarily, sometimes permanently, their skills, their knowledge, their insight. And comrades, this is happening to this party. We are losing the bigger picture. We are in danger of losing the bigger picture. What should have been compulsory for all socialist worker members here at Marxism should have been the life of Brian. You know, wreckers, splitters, be careful.
Thank you, comrade. The next speaker will be followed by that comrade there.
Hello, I'm Oscar from Barcelona. I'm going to explain a little the experience of the Indignados movement. I'm very lucky for live that, and the reason is that my birthday is the 15th of May, and the day that started the movement. Then, Colin had make some interesting points. We start the first night in Barcelona after the attacking of the police of the demonstration in Madrid. We started 40 person camping in Barcelona. By the end of the week, we were 10,000 leaving the street. The second thing I learned is a revolutionary movement or a huge movement is a mess, and you need clarification. You need clarification. You have a lot of inputs, and you have to be organized. The second thing is that the process of learning is huge, and I want to tell three experiences. At the first moment, the movement was like very peaceful. And after a month, and being hit by the police, resisting the police 2 days, we launched a proposal that blocking the parliament against the budget cuts. 5,000 people camping outside the parliament this night. The government kick us. The president go by helicopter to the parliament and then try to criminalize all of us in the TVs, radio, newspapers. We launched a demonstration 3 days after. The people thought, we had failed, the people had lost the confidence. 200,000 people marching from Barcelona and maybe 1 million all over the country. This is a change in the mind of the people where the democracy is. This second experience, we have a food committee, and a health committee at the square, organized by doctor and nurse. These doctors and nurses are organizing the occupation now in the hospitals and had rejected the bureaucracy to accept a budget cut now in Catalonia. And the third amazing thing was we, with the anarchists, the most advanced anarchists, tried to make a proposal to push forward the movement, to coordinate the assemblies, and we failed. And that's the reason that we failed, that now seems that the movement is not going on. But I think we have to be optimistic, because beyond the whole picture, the things are moving. And that's my point. Thank you.
Thank you, comrade. The next comrade will be followed by the guy in the grey T-shirt.
One of the things that I really liked about the way Colin introduced this discussion is that he reminded us that the ideas and principles of revolutionary socialism, of Marxism, came from the experience of workers themselves. It wouldn't come fully formed into Marx's head by some falling out of the sky. But actually, he changed his positions and learned from what workers did, not simply starting with the Paris Commune, of course, but right back to the 1840s, to his first engagement with the textile workers in Germany, in Silesia, who went on strike, who changed his view around democracy, and so on and so forth. And I think this is really important, because Marxist ideas, revolutionary socialist ideas, for most people, most of the time, are things that are not, you know, not something that can be deduced from their own experience. That's what a revolution changes, is it makes those ideas and those principles deducible, capable of being distilled out of the everyday practice and experience of millions of people. And this is actually a process you can see going on in Egypt at the moment. So, for example, those principles around workers' democracy that Colin talked about actually are part of the everyday practice of strike organizing in Egypt. I met one of the leaders of the bus workers in Cairo about a year and a half ago. I asked him to help to record a message of support and solidarity for London bus workers who are about to go on strike. And I said, what's your message to them? And he said, don't trust the trade union bureaucracy. They will sell you out. And he described how they have an elected committee of in every strike. The negotiators are elected directly by a mass meeting. If they go and negotiate, they have to come back to a mass meeting. And in mass meetings in Egypt, they throw shoes at them if they get it wrong. And they removed them. And in fact, his union, they did remove the president who had just been elected after the revolution and who had led strikes and so on, because he did a bad deal and they thought that it wasn't, the rank and file rejected it. That's an example of how in everyday practice those ideas can come up. But there are also other people around, as, for example, Colin mentioned, reformists around. I mean, one of the people actually who spoke at Marxism 2 years ago, Kamala Buaita, who is the president of the was the president of the Independent Federation of Trade Unions in Egypt, who is a reformist, has just taken a post as Minister of Labour under the current government and is moving in an absolutely classic reformist direction, away from that experience. So the question is, you know, how can people distill out of their own experience these principles and apply them anew? And that's where Colin's point about a revolutionary organisation is crucial, because people will do these things. They do these things, but they don't necessarily know what they're doing with them. They don't necessarily see the implications for expanding that from what they do in the strike to what they do in that this could be a model for running society differently. They don't necessarily see in terms of how to develop that into something that can be a model for a new society. And that, to me, is where you know, the Revolutionary Party comes in, not as some kind of model that comes on from outside.
Wind up, please.
And not in a kind of mechanical way with a checklist. People use language you don't expect. But in a way where people do take again what they've done themselves in their own everyday practice and turn it into an organised way in which we can change society.
Thanks, comrade. The next speaker will be followed by the guy with the beard.
Richard Boyd Barrett, the badly paid Irish MP. I just want to make a point about experimentation, which Colin made the point that in revolutions there's a tremendous outburst of experimentation by the mass of people and creativity. And we don't create revolutions in revolutionary organizations, but we have to prepare for a situation where masses of people begin to do things themselves, use their own imaginations, do different things, things that we didn't necessarily expect. And I think this is critically important. And by way of example of a contrast to both a good and bad in the Irish experience recently, we had a big fight over the opposition to an austerity tax, the household tax. Much of the left said, this is the battle. This will be the decisive battle. And there was predictions, there was going to be uprisings, and so on. And they said, we must put everything into this. And they had one tactic. Now, we were very much part of that. But about a year ago, we said, actually, we better be careful here. Because you can't predict which battle will be the battle, which front and which people will fight, or that there will be only one front. And we made an argument, yes, we must put a lot into this, but also we must open up to other struggles that are happening. Because some people are motivated by the fight against the household tax. Some are motivated by the fact that their kids have special needs and special needs has been cut. Young people aren't particularly interested in household taxes because they don't get household bills. But they might be interested in the way capitalism degrades culture, for example. Other people are turf cutters and are having their traditional means of providing their families with fuel taken away from them. Other people in rural areas are worried about their local school being cut or whatever. And all of these people are fighting, so we have to open up. Or forests, which I didn't know anything about until 6 months ago, but there was a plan to privatise the forests while the other fight is going on in the household tax. And we made an argument that says we've got to be involved in this. And thank God we did, because the boycott against the household tax eventually collapsed, and much of the left's confidence collapsed with it. Meanwhile, we were the only people who built a very, very broad coalition around forestry, united the rural areas with the urban areas, united artists who have a big interest in forests for obvious reasons, we united farmers, all sorts of people into a movement that won and stopped the privatisation of the forests and gave people confidence, right? And so we have to be experimental. But can I just say, to be experimental, you have to have an organization of a certain size. Okay? You can't do all of the things that people are doing and be alongside them unless you have an organization of a sufficient size. And critically, and I just want to make this point and maybe ask Colin to respond on it, you see, yes, there will be unexpected mobilizations from quarters we don't expect, and we have to respond to them. But the organized working class is still key. And it is the weakness, for example, in Ireland, that the Irish ruling class are very conscious of, that they have sat on public sector workers and used their influence in them. And this has been a problem in terms of unifying the movement. So the next step is to link all that energy and spontaneity and creativity that is coming from all sorts of quarters into the heart of the organized working class. And this is where revolutionary perspective and organization. And when we say, where are our Pugilov factories? They are the hospitals. They are the transport workers. They are the shopping centers where you get thousands of retail workers together. They are the universities. They are all sorts of places. They're slightly different from the Pugilov factories, but they are absolutely critical, and we have to link all the movements into those organized working class centers.
The next comrade will be followed by the woman.
Yeah. Hello, Gordon Davy from Edinburgh, Scotland, soon to be an independent country. Maybe. Nothing is guaranteed in life. I would like to speak about the anger which unites all of us who have worked or do work. That is anger about the way we are abused by authority in the workplace. I think it's crucial in what organises us and makes us feel part of the same movement, the same experience. I just watched a documentary called Fire in the Night about the explosion and fire on the oil rig 25 years ago, where 167 men were burnt to death because the company insisted on pumping gas and oil into a rig on which they were carrying out maintenance. The only way that could have been stopped was if the men had the confidence in the organization to say, no, we're not doing that, that's not safe, we're not doing it. But because people have authority, they say, if you don't do it, you're fired. Now, in a revolutionary situation, workers say, we're not doing it, it's unsafe, and you're not firing us, we're firing you. On the helicopter and away. That situation will be repeated in countless workplaces. People will refuse to do work as unsafe. They will refuse to be abused by their boss. Women who have been abused sexually by bosses and ask for sexual favours in return for work. We'll know who was doing it, and they will say, your authority is now gone. You will never have authority here ever again. And by the way, your job is now cleaning the toilets. Here's the mop, here's the bucket, get on with it. People who have never done a day's work in their lives, except to lord it over other people, will be put to work. That's what will happen in a revolution. And people who have all their lives done the shittiest work will teach others how to do it and start doing something more interesting. Or we will share it. I don't know. We cannot predict how it will be done. But all the dirtiest jobs will be shared. We will no longer have small numbers of people doing all the crap. We'll all take a turn. And all the bosses will be working night shifts. And all the bosses will be caring after elderly people who are incontinent. And they'll be doing all the jobs that they've never done in their lives and we've had to do. So the dirtiest jobs are shared out. That's very important. Everyone earns the same. Very important. And no abuse of power of any kind is tolerated. Some people may be given authority to run projects. Maybe not. I don't know. But if they are given authority, it's on the condition that they do not abuse that authority. And the moment they do, they're out. One last point. Annie said, rightly so, that there are problems in the party with differences resulting in people being abusive to each other. That's not acceptable, ever. During our discussion in Edinburgh, I once lost my temper and shouted at one of my comrades about the discussion. I then apologised because I knew I was wrong. We don't need to be abusive to people. We have to respect people. We expect workers in the workplace to respect each other. We have to set the example that we don't do it.
Thank you, comrade. The next comrade will be the last speaker in the discussion, and apologies to all of the people that put the hands up, but there were so many hands I couldn't call everybody.
Well, as a health worker who works a lot of night shifts and deals with a lot of people who are incontinent, I'm delighted to hear that some of my bosses will be doing that very difficult job after the revolution. I thought it was really interesting what Colin said about how one of the first things a revolution should try and do in Britain is not the most ambitious of things, but is to give a house and enough to eat to everybody. And I think it tells you something about the world that we live in, that actually we would have to have a revolution to achieve what really seems like such a humble goal. But we know from history that this is the case, don't we? But obviously it's not just about the humble goals of the house and something to eat. As Colin quite rightly himself has said, we want to reclaim everything that's good about our society. And I think that's why you see in every upheaval the huge creativity and the potential that ordinary people have. I think when I read, there are many brilliant writings about the Russian Revolution, but some of my favourites are actually the writings of Victor Serge, who writes during the Civil War period, after the revolution, about how the importance of art, of opera, of music, that even in the darkest hours of the revolution, ordinary people want everything that we should be entitled to, explore what it is to be human. And so we have very humble aspirations, don't we? But we also have very ambitious aspirations about the things that should belong to all of us. You see, I think it's quite clear when you hear from people from different parts of the world that ordinary, I don't believe in the term ordinary because I don't believe we're ordinary. I think working class people are extraordinary. But that what they call ordinary people are capable of amazing things. And we see this, you know, Marx talked about every revolution begins with flowers. At the beginning of every revolutionary upsurge, and not just revolutionary upsurge, every mass movement, there is a huge feeling of unity. But that unity doesn't go on forever, because every movement comes up against a whole series of arguments, strategic questions. Do you advance? Do you retreat? Do you trust the army? All the things that Colin has talked about. And that is why we have to have a group of organised socialists, not who turn up on the barricades going, look at my programme, I've got something to say about this, follow me, but who are rooted in every campaign, every struggle, every movement, who can point the way forwards, who win people's trust, who listen to people, who argue with people, but who can say, come on, we can advance, we can take the movement from the street to the factories, we can move forwards, the things that we're capable of. They have to take an organisational form. To conduct an argument on that sort of scale, you have to have an organisational way of doing that. And that is what a revolutionary party is for. Two final points. Colin talks about economics and politics. I think it's very interesting thing to talk about, and we can't solve all of the problems of the future socialist society. We have to struggle to get there, but it is worth thinking about some of these. Firstly, how can we solve an economic crisis? And one of the important things about this, I think, is that an economic crisis cannot be solved within the boundaries of a national state. And I'm sure nobody disagrees with that. We all know the economic crisis is international. I'm just throwing that in there. There cannot be a socialist revolution that is not international. This was true when the Bolsheviks were fighting to change the world, and this is true absolutely writ large in our day. The second thing, the final thing really, is similar to previous speakers and the questions that Colin raised about where are our future centres of power going to lie. And I absolutely agree with the people. There are some things we don't know where they're going to necessarily lie, but we do know that they have to involve workers organising as workers to solve some of the problems that we're going to have in a socialist society. So to deal with the questions of food, of health, of all of these different things. So yes, we may not have Putilov, but we will have our hospitals. We will organise, and you see battles around organisation of the health service in Greece, for example, and you think about somewhere like, how are we going to organise food production? The second biggest industry in Britain at the moment are supermarkets. You can start to see, if we seize control of those and they were produced not for profit but for human need, there are loads of things, aren't there, comrades, that we could grab hold of, that we could use for the good of the many, not for the few.
Okay, if Colin likes some more.
Yeah, comrades, usually when you're summing up, you have to deal with the objections that have been made to what you said. I didn't hear any. You have to deal with the questions you were asked. I wasn't asked any. So I'll just make an observation and shut up. We all agree. That is a fantastic thing to say at the end of Marxism. We actually have a vision. We all share it. Let's build it. And let's all go and sing the Internationale. Thank you very much.